Today we are going to see how to find out overall efficiency of the power screw, then torque required to overcome the collar pitching, and last one, stresses induced in screw and nut. Now let us start today's session. Learning objective of the today's session are: calculate the collar friction torque. Why collar friction torque? Yesterday we have seen, we have calculated, you know, the efficiency of the square threaded screw. That time we have considered only the friction between the threaded surface. Threaded surface means in between screw and the nut. But we are not taking into account the collar friction. So today we are going to take into account this collar friction and how much torque is required to overcome this collar friction, that we are going to determine. Then second learning objective of the today's session, to find out the overall efficiency of the power screw. Why the word overall is used here? Because, you know, day before yesterday we have derived the expression for square threaded screw, as well as yesterday we have seen the efficiency of the Acme and trapezoidal thread. But the word overall is used because in while finding out the efficiency, we are going to take into account the torque required to raise the load, that means the to overcome the friction between the threaded surface, as well as the torque required to overcome the collar friction, and based on that you will get the overall efficiency of the power screw. Today we will see this point also. And third objective of the today's session, design of screw and nut, and it is totally based on the, you can say, the rational design, that means which type of stresses are going to induce in it. And based on that, we are going to find out the dimensions of the screw and the nut. Today we will see all these aspects during the session. Now, you know very well, to raise the load, here, the power screw consists of basically three parts or three elements. You can say first one is the nut, second one is the screw, and third one is the frame. Why third element is frame? It gives support to the, maybe to the nut or maybe to the screw. Based on that, so actually while to raise the load or to lower the load, there is a relative motion or the moment between this nut and the screw. And because of that, there is a friction between the threaded surfaces. Threaded surfaces mean in between nut and the screw. And we have already seen how much is the torque required to raise the load and how much is the torque required to lower the load. This is one thing. But in some of the applications, such as screw jacks and the other application, you will find, I am going to show here also, you will find, look at this here. This is the part of a screw jack. Here this part is a cup over which here load, or it gives support to the load, and it is going to rotate freely on the screw here. Try to understand. It is going to rotate freely on the screw. This part is a screw, here it is mentioned. Again, this screw is having a collar, and this collar is an integrated part of the screw. During the raising the load, what is happening here? When you are going to raise this screw, or after giving some revolution or a rotation, you will find the moment of the screw which is going to happen because of the lid. And this, the, you know, the cup part here, look at this dark portion here. This dark portion, what is happening? There is a friction between the cup part and the collar part. And because of that, this cup which is coming in contact with the collar, and there is, you will find, if you are going to observe in top view here, from this, the DI here, it is mentioned inner diameter of the collar, and DO is the outer diameter of the collar. You can observe the, here this annular area or the ring, which is subjected to the collar friction. And to overcome this collar friction, further some torque which is required. And we are going to see here, first of all, collar friction torque. That means in some of the application, such a situation arises where collar friction plays the important role. And because of that, torque required to raise the load or to lower the load, which is more than the torque, calculated torque, that is the important point. That's why while calculating the torque, always you have to remember there are two types of the torque. Here I have mentioned the torque required to overcome the collar friction, that is second type of torque, and the first one, torque required to raise and lower the load, where the friction which is in between the screw and the nut or the thread surfaces, that is the important thing. And where you will observe this collar friction in between the cup and the collar of the screw, collar is the integral part of the screw. That's why in this annular area or the interface, you will find there is a collar friction. Again, second thing, suppose the torque which is applied to raise the load by using a, you know, the Tommy bar report is applied, and always you know very well this frictional force which is opposite to the direction of rotation. It tries to resist that motion or rotation also. Try to understand this thing. That's why relative motion between this cup and the collar at the annular interface results in collar friction. This is the second thing or second part that we have to take into account. Then how to determine this collar friction? That is important one. To determine this collar friction, the collar friction is determined by using the two theories. One is the uniform pressure theory and second one is the uniform wear theory. Again, in the theory of machine or term two, you already studied this part. This is about the design of clutch. Design of clutch. While designing the clutch, maybe single plate clutch or a multi plate clutch, you know very well what is happening. There is a friction lining material which comes in direct contact with the driving plane, with the driven plane, because of the friction lining material. And again, the friction lining material which is stick to this annular ring portion in case of a clutch. And because of that, what is happening here, how much is the torque required, this friction, we are going to determine using the same fundamental already used here in design of clutch. And in clutch design, we have used these two theories. These two theories are, one, first one is the uniform pressure theory and second one is the uniform wear theory. That means in general, collar friction torque or torque required to overcome the collar friction is determined by using first uniform pressure theory or uniform wear theory. Again, you know very well when to go for a uniform pressure theory and when to go for a uniform wear theory. If clutch is a new one and there is no any friction, that means after manufacturing, it's a new one. That's why you will find the uniform distribution of the pressure over this annular ring or the annular interface. And that's why uniform pressure theory is applicable to the new clutch or the new element. But when to use a uniform wear theory, and after some period of time, so you know very well, some portion of the friction lining material or the where the contact of the collar and the cups. Where it comes in contact, you will find that because of this, the relative motion between the cup and the collar, so you will find some material or worn out of the maybe collar or maybe cup which is going to occur. And because of that, uniform wear theory you can use during the application. That means after some period of time, the worn out of the material is going to occur, maybe for collar or the cup, depends on the which type of material is for the collar and the cup. This is about the theories. Now you know very well, already you studied this part in second year theory of machine two, the topic that is clutch. I don't want to derive further this derivation. It's very simple one. So by using this derivation, we can easily find out the torque required to overcome the collar friction. Now let us see what is the relation according to uniform pressure theory. Now according to uniform pressure theory, you know very well, 2/3 mu w n into r o cube minus r I cube upon r o square minus r I square. R o and r I is the outer radius of the collar, inner radius of the collar. Similarly here, it is written in terms of the diameter. DO is the outer diameter of the collar and DI is the inner diameter of the collar. And according to this uniform pressure theory, MTC, look at the nomenclature, MTC, torque required, MT is the torque and C is the suffix which is used. This is for collar friction, try to understand. The MTC is the torque required to overcome the collar friction is given by uniform pressure theory is mu c into w by 3 into dv cube minus di cube upon dv square minus di cube. Again here mu c is written, mu is the coefficient of friction between the contacting surfaces, but again here c is the suffix is used, that means it's a coefficient of friction between the collar and the cup, or which is applicable for the collar surfaces. Again this theory is applicable when the collar surface is new. I have already discussed this thing. Then second theory is a uniform wear theory. And when to use the uniform wear theory, I have already mentioned, collar surface gets worn out after some period of time. That means this theory is applicable during the running condition or after some period of time. And according to this uniform wear theory, here MTC, that means torque required to overcome the collar friction, is equal to mu c into w by 4 in bracket dv plus di. And you know very well dv is the outer diameter of the collar, di inner diameter of the collar. It is mentioned here, look at this, mu c is the coefficient of friction at the collar and w is the load which is acting on the cup. You know, in earlier slide I have shown the diagram here. Here W which is acting vertically downward, or you can say it's a normal. Look at this, this W here. This is the W. So in this way, by using these two theories, uniform pressure theory and uniform wear theory, you can easily find out the torque required to overcome the collar friction. That means sometimes in examination, it may be provided, find out the torque required to overcome the collar friction by using uniform pressure theory, or torque required to overcome the collar friction by using uniform wear theory. Suppose if it is not mentioned while designing the power screw, what to do and which theory you are going to select? That time what you have to do, because uniform pressure theory is applicable to newly designed elements or a clutch or a collar or a cup, and uniform wear theory is applicable for a running condition. So that's why always, if it is not mentioned, always prefer uniform wear theory. Try to understand, don't say like this, it is not mentioned, that's why I have taken use the formula of uniform pressure theory. If it is not mentioned, always go for a uniform wear theory. Try to understand. And how to derive the expression? It's very simple. Look at this. This DO plus DI by 4, you will get the mean radius. If you are going to write in terms of DO means 2RO plus DI means 2RI. And again here, what you will get? By 4, you can take 2 common, you will get by 2. So what re-expression you will get? Mu c into w by 2 into r mean. So in radius, mean radius also you can derive this expression. And I am on how to derive it. It's very simple. Look at this, torque is nothing but a force into radius. What is torque? Force into radius. But here we have to take into account there is a frictional force at the mean collar diameter, and that's why there is a friction in between collar surface of the cup or maybe collar of the screw. And because of that, mu c, that you have to multiply it by the mu c or coefficient of friction, or you can say the frictional for mu c into w into radius, you will get the torque directly. And dm is the mean radius, I have already told, that is dv plus di by 2. So in this way you can derive this for the uniform wear theory. So what is the concluding remark from this collar friction torque? So there are two types of friction in power screw. First one, which is in between screw and nut. To overcome this friction, torque required to raise the load, that we have to find out, number one. Number two, in some of the application, collar is an integral part of the screw, and the cup where the load which is supported on the part which comes in contact with the collar, and because of that there is a collar friction. And again, how to overcome this collar friction. So again, we have to find out the torque required this collar friction or to overcome this collar friction. These two types of torque we have to find out, and you can edit torque required to overcome the threaded friction against the thread surface and friction against the collar. And by adding it, you will get the total torque required to raise the load. Try to understand. And again, in collar friction, how to find out the torque required to overcome this collar friction? So you have to use two theories, uniform pressure theory, uniform wear theory. And when to use which theory, that is also important for Newley elements, uniform pressure, and running condition, uniform wear theory. And if it is not mentioned, you can go for a uniform wear theory. Try to understand. Again, second interesting thing I would like to share with you, that is look at the again earlier side. I will go on this slide here. Now in this case, look at this here. At this portion, there is a direct contact of collar and this cup. That's why there is a collar friction. This dark black I am showing by here by this pen. Look at this. But in some of the cases, instead of that, now suppose this is the cup, this is the screw, and instead of having a collar here, what is used? Thrust ball bearings are used. Instead of collar, thrust ball bearings are used. Try to understand. In some of these screw jacks or the power screws. And when such a thrust ball bearings are used, that time, what is going to happen? This sliding friction between the collar and cup is replaced by rolling friction. And this rolling friction is very, very small, or you can say it's negligible one. That's why, while designing certain power screw, if you are going to use a thrust ball bearing, by or collar is replaced by a thrust ball bearing, that time no need to consider torque required to overcome the collar friction. Try to understand. I hope you are getting this point. It's very important one. That means if you are going to use a collar, you can find out the torque required to overcome it. And if you are going to use a thrust ball bearing instead of a collar, no need to consider the or to count the collar friction, and don't determine the torque required to overcome this friction. It's very, very small or negligible. That's why you can neglect it. And why we are neglecting? And because of this thrust ball bearing, sliding friction is replaced by rolling friction. Try to understand these things. This is about the collar friction torque. Now let us move to the another important point, overall efficiency of the power screw. Now because of this collar friction, what is happened? The torque required to raise the load. Now here I am going to use the nomenclature. Look at this. This nomenclature you have to also use, because I am referring V.V. Bhandari's book, McGraw-Hill publication. You can also refer the same book, and all the nomenclature taken from that book. Try to understand. MTT is the total torque required to raise the load. But there are two types of torque which are required to overcome the friction. The first one, torque required to overcome the friction at the thread surface. Thread surface means in between screw and the nut. And second one, as discussed now, torque required to overcome the collar friction. This is one and this is second. And I am going to write therefore, total torque required to overcome the friction is equal to torque required to overcome the friction at the thread and torque required to overcome the friction at the collar. And therefore, MTT means total torque required. MT is the nomenclature which is used for the thread surface or in between screw and the thread. And MTC, C suffix is used for the collar. Try to understand. So you can refer this. You can note down this. MTT is equal to MT plus MTC. This MTT means total torque required to raise the load. And based on that, we are going to determine overall efficiency of the power screw. And how to find out this overall efficiency? Now you know very well, we have seen what is the work output of the power screw. You know very well, this is lead, then here is the load, and the inclined surface is the screw surface, and again here pi d m is the circumference of the developed screw. And when load which is raised from this point to up to this, during one revolution, what is happening? The advancement of the screw is by some distance, that is lead. That means what is the work output? To raise the load means to raise the load by this L distance. Therefore, work output, already we have used this expression while finding out the efficiency of the square head screw. Therefore, work output is equal to force into distance traveled in the direction of force. So how much is the distance traveled in the direction of the force? Force, that is W, which is acting vertically downward. So L, and force is W. So W into L is the work output. And what is the efficiency? It is overall efficiency. That's why O is suffix is used. That is work output upon work input. Now work output means W into L. Try to understand, which is same like a square threaded screw. Now let us find out work input. Now in this case, to find out the overall efficiency, work input. Now in work input, we have to consider the total torque required to overcome the both friction. Both means thread surface friction and the polar friction. I will explain it on next slide. Let us see. In this case, you will find work input means torque applied to the screw. Now, how much is the torque applied? The total torque, that is MTT. MTT means total torque, which includes, or it's an addition of torque required to overcome the thread surface friction and torque required to overcome the collar friction. And this torque multiplied by angle turn through, the 2 pi. It's simple. Again, it's like this, or you can say the effort or the P, or I am going to write here, you know, the torque means force into R. F into R is the torque, and into 2 pi, the 2 pi R is the circumference, or in terms of pi dm also you can write, no problem. Pi dm, dm means again 2R. It's the same expression I have written. Only here it is written in terms of total torque, MTT. It's a work input. And again, you know very well, overall efficiency is equal to work output upon work input. And what is work output? W into L. What is work input? MTT into 2 pi. After substituting this, what you will get? Overall efficiency is equal to W into L upon 2 pi into MTT. You can note down this expression. Sometimes in university examination, they are asking to find out your overall efficiency of the power screw. That's that time you have to use this expression. This expression means you have to find out this MTT, and this MTT means total torque. And this total torque is nothing but torque required to overcome the thread friction and torque required to overcome the collar friction. And again, how to find out this collar friction? Uniform pressure theory, uniform wear theory. And MT, I have already explained, while raising the load, we have already determined the MT to raise the load and to lower the load in square threaded and in ACME and trapezoidal threaded screw also. This is about the overall efficiency of the screw. Now let us see next point, design of screw and nut. And it's very important from the power screw design point of view. Now before that, I have mentioned there is a friction between screw and thread. There is a friction between collar and cup. And because of that, to overcome this friction, we are using, or we are finding out the torque required to overcome the friction. And to find out this frictional force, always we have to use a coefficient of friction term, which is at a thread surface and which is at a collar surface. So this coefficient of friction, which is depends on, try to understand what I am telling now. It depends on the workmanship in cutting thread while manufacturing the thread on the screw and while manufacturing the thread on the nut. The value of mu depends on this workmanship in cutting the thread. That means manufacturing. And then second, coefficient of friction, this mu depends on the type of lubricant. Try to understand. But it is independent on the load which is to be raised or lowered. Then rubbing velocity. Rubbing velocity means when two surfaces when comes in contact, and because of that there is a friction, maybe sliding, maybe rolling, whatever may be, and because of that you have to find out this the rubbing velocity. So it is it depends on the rubbing velocity also, and it is independent on material also. Try to understand. So you can note down the coefficient of friction at thread surface and the collar surface depends on the manufacturing of the thread, maybe for screw or the nut, and type of lubricant used, and independent on load, independent on rubbing velocity, and independent of material. Try to understand these things. This is about the coefficient of friction. But in general, while designing the power screw, if it is not mentioned and data is not given, that time generally you have to assume coefficient of friction mu is equal to 0.15 at the thread surface. I am talking about thread surface means in between screw and in between screw and nut. How much value that you have to assume? Mu is equal to 0.15, and when lubricated with mineral oil. Try to understand. But for a collar friction, that means collar and neck cup, here I have given a chart, and which is depends on which type of material which is used for a collar and which is used for a cup. The generally cup which is made up of a cast iron, sometimes screw which is made up of because collar is an integral part of the screw, made up of soft steel, hardened steel, soft steel, hardened steel. The combination of this collar and cup, combination of this the two mating or contacting parts are given here, and based on that the value of mu c is given in data book. You can refer any data book, no problem. So you will find starting the value of mu c, coefficient of friction for collar, 0.17, and running is a 0.12. That means starting friction coefficient of friction is high and running coefficient of friction is low. So you can select the values of this mu c by referring this chart, which type of material is for the collar or a thread screw, and which type of material used for a cup or contacting part. And again I have told you, if collar is replaced by a thrust ball bearing, that time this friction which is going gets reduced by 1/10 of the plane sliding surface. 1/10. Try to understand. So whatever the value of coefficient of friction, you can divide by 10, so you will get very low value. Suppose it is in the range of 0.01 to 0.02. Try to understand if thrust ball bearing is used, and that's why we are neglecting the effect of collar friction. I have already mentioned to you. And even though if someone is going to ask thrust ball bearing is used, how much is the coefficient of friction between the contacting that ball and the screw part or the cup part, that time you can say 1/10 into the combination of material which is used for contacting surfaces. That means you have to divide by 10. Try to understand to obtain the value of coefficient of friction when thrust ball bearings are used. Otherwise no need to consider the effect of this, the torque required to overcome the collar friction. Assuming very very negligible torque required to overcome the collar friction when thrust ball bearings are used, you can do that like this. This is about the coefficient of friction. Now I am starting design of screw and the nut. Now let us see. Now here you know very well, first of all try to understand this the figure. Now here the hatchings or the this hatch portion is nothing but a nut portion. Try to understand, it's a nut. This nut is also having here, look at this, this the thread. Nut is also having thread. Then this portion, look at this, the pen I am over writing on the figure. This part is a screw. Try to understand. Now here this is nut. Again this nut which is fitted in the frame or a body part. Which is fitted in a frame or a body part. It gives supports to this nut. Or in some of the cases it goes supports to the screw also, and because of that many times I have told you power screw consists of basically three elements. The first element is screw. This is very important one. Second one is the nut. This part is a nut. Here, this part is a nut. And third one is the frame. It gives supports, or in frame, this nut part may be fitted, and it prevents its relative movement, or it is used to lock the nut or the screw as per the application. So basically three parts: screw, nut, and frame. Again here, while selecting the material, before design of the screw, we have to select the material. And what is the criteria to select the material for the screw? So these materials should have a sufficient strength, try to understand, to withstand the stresses due to external load and applied torque. Applied torque means to raise the load, we have to apply the effort by using the Tommy bar, by using a rod or cylindrical rod. Because of that, that means it should sustain for this applied torque. This is one. And second, this screw should sustain for a load. External load means where to lift that load, or to give the support by using the power screw, to withstand the stresses induced because of this external load as well as the applied torque. That means screw material should have a sufficient strength. This is one requirement. Second one, you know very well, this is the nut and this is the screw. There is a contact, and because of that, to lift the load, when we are going to apply the torque, because of that, screw is going to rotate, and there is a contact between screw and the nut, and because of that, there may be possibility of wear of the screw threaded part or wear of the nut threaded part. Therefore, screw material should have high wear resistance capacity. This is the second requirement. And third one, we have to manufacture the thread on the cylindrical rod as well as on this nut part. The good machinability is the requirement for the material. And these are three are the basic requirement or desirable properties of the screw material. And you know very well, based on that, which type of material generally preferred. The first one is the plain carbon steel, right on the plain carbon steel, also used in case of shafts also. The plain carbon steel material which is recommended 30C8, 40C8, 45C8, and alloy steel, that is 40 chromium 1. So you can remember plain carbon steel 30C8, 40C8, 45C8. That means low, medium carbon steel, and alloy steel means 40 chromium 1. Again, here in some of the cases, screws are case hardened. Hardening, that means on the surface, you know very well. In material science or metallurgy, you studied different heat treatment processes, case hardening. Up to certain limit, the surface of the screw, which is hardened by the heat treatment process. And generally, you know, in the case of lathe machine, that is lead screw, by nitriding process, the hardening which is carrying out by nitriding. That means, again here, threaded portion of the screw, which is case hardened in some of the cases, depends on the application. And the high wear resistance requirement, because relative motion between the screw and nut, wear is inevitable. There is a wear. And therefore, these screw parts or screw material should have a sufficient strength, high resisting wear property, or a good machinability. It's okay. But if we are going to use this, say, you know, the nut part, but here compared of the screw, this nut should be soft and conformable. Conformable means according to the thread of the screw, it is going to accommodate with the thread of the screw. That is conformability. And therefore, material used for the nut should be soft than that of screw. And you know very well, bronze is the ideal material for the nut. It's a very soft material. And again, the bronze, you know very well, tin bronze or the phosphor bronze, you can use for a nut. Try to understand. That means, what are the materials for screw and nut? You know very well now, plain carbon steel, 30C8, 40C8, 45C8 or alloy steel for a screw, and soft material for a not and you know very well what is the soft material, maybe phosphor bronze or a tin bronze or in general bronze. Try to understand that material which is used for enough. Now question arises, we are going to select a high sufficient strength material to the screw, but we are selecting the soft material for the nut. Why? Because nut is a small part and total load which is coming on the screw, which is more than the nut, it gives the support, is okay. But failure of the nut, if which is going to occur, we can easily manufacture by using this phosphor bronze or a bronze material. It's a cheaper one, it's a small parts, it's a easily replaceable part, and cost associated which is also less than the screw part. Again, to manufacture the screw, you know the manufacturing cost of the screw, that period portion is difficult one. That's why cost, manufacturing cost associated with the screw is also more. That's why the bronze or the soft material which is used for a nut, and because of that in general you will find nut is going to fail first than the screw, and we can easily replace that nut because of the cost associated with it. Or you can say it's a economical consideration to replace the nut than the screw. That is the logic. That's why soft material which is used for a nut, like you know the key in case of flange coupling, I have mentioned the key generally is having the material strength less than the your the shaft as well as the flange, and the first of all key should fail. Instead of filling the in driving flange or the driven flange or the input shaft or the output shaft, because of the cost associated, and it's a very, you know, the simple component having the simple cross section, we can easily manufacture in the workshop also. That is the reason for that. Try to understand this. This is about the material used for the screw. Now let us see which type of stresses are going to induce in it. Now 10 minutes remaining, within that I will cover this part, no problem. The body of the screw is subjected to, you know very well, I am going to show you again here this part. Look at the part here, W. The body of the screw here, which is subjected to load, and because of this load, compressive stresses are going to induce in the screw. Again, here in nomenclature, I am going to mention DC, core diameter or a minor diameter or a smaller diameter. This small d is the nominal diameter or a large diameter or a major diameter. Again, look at this t. T is the thickness of threaded portion of the screw part, and as well as it is going to engage with the nut, and this thickness for the screw and thickness for the nut which is remain same, because we are going to use this nomenclature dc, then small d and t. And another one nomenclature is the small z, that means number of threaded threads. Now look at this, because of this W, what is happening? Screw is subjected to axial force W. W means load to be raised or to be lowered, and it is also subjected to torsional moment. And torsional moment, you have to consider the total torque required, MTT. And why the torsional moment? Because to raise the load or lower the load, effort which is applied by using the Tommy bar. That's why even though in screw jacks we are using the, you know, there is a wheel or a rod, we are rotating it, that means we are applying the effort. And because of this axial force, direct compressive stress sigma c gets induced in it. And how to find out the sigma c? Just simply elementary equation, force upon area, the load means W upon area, pi by 4 into dc square, is a core diameter or a smaller diameter. By if suppose you know very well material for the screw, you can find out based on that SYT is equal to SYC, or compressive stress are more than the shear stress. You know very well from that you can find out the permissible sigma c by using FOS and find out the DC, or you can easily find out the sigma c induced in it or compressive stress induced in the screw. Whatever may be the logic we have used in knuckle joint and quarter joint, the same logic we have to apply here, but you should know the relations very well. So first of all, direct compressive stress because of this load, by using this elementary equation, we can easily find out the sigma c or we can find out the DC core diameter of the screw. This is one thing. Second thing, effort is applied to rotate it to raise the load. And because of that, torsional moment or torsional shear stresses are going to induce in it. And how to find out this torsional shear stress? Because of this torsional moment, again, you know very well, it's a cylindrical rod. The same expression of a shaft we are going to use. Tau is equal to, for a circular cross section, 16 MTT upon pi DC cube. Here DC cube means core diameter of the screw. MTT means total torque required, that is MT plus MTC. Try to understand. MT plus MTC. This total torque required to overcome the threaded surface friction and collar friction that you have to use. DC you will get from this expression, or maybe given you will get the shear stress, torsional shear stress. And you can check it. This torsional shear stress induced whether it is less than the permissible shear stress. And how to find out the permissible shear stress? So if you know the SYT, the 0.5 SYT, you will get the tau S. 0.5 SYT upon FOS, you will get the tau permissible. By using this expression, you can check it, induced shear stress. And once you know this tau, once you know this sigma C, according to principal shear stress theory, you know very well, tau max is equal to tau C by 2 bracket square plus this tau. You can substitute all this value, you will get tau max. And again, you can use is equal to in the formula of 16 or 32, depends on what dimension you have to calculate. Here you can find out the maximum stress also. And this maximum stress we can use to find out the dimension. Then interesting thing here in case of screw and nut, what is happening? Try to understand. The transverse shear stress in nut and transverse shear stress in screw. So what is the transverse shear stress? What is happening? Look at the diagram. I will explain first of all. Look at this. What is happening here? Look at this. Now this is screw. This screw part which is coming here in contact with the threaded portion of the nut. Threaded. And because of this load, there may be possibility of shear off of the threaded portion of the screw. Threaded portion of the screw and vice versa. Vice versa means, now look at this. This is the portion of a nut part and where the threaded portion which is coming, and because of the load, shear of the threaded as well as threaded portion of the nut which is going to occur. Try to understand. There are two logic. One is, but while considering the nut, which dimension you have to consider here, which is coming to up to D, DC, and when we are going to consider the screw, the D is going to play the important role. That is transverse shear stress plays important role. And to find out this transverse shear stress, what you have to do? First of all, you have to find out the transverse shear area. And how to find out this transverse shear area? The two cases we have to consider. So you will get the idea from this. The transverse shear stress in the screw is equal to transverse shear stress tau S. S suffix is used for screw. And this is shear stress. The transverse shear stress in the screw is equal to force upon area. But what is the area? Pi into DC into T. T is the thickness. Once again, I will show you here in the screw diagram. Look at this. Look at this here. In screw, what is happening up to this portion? Up to this. Look at this. This portion. This portion of the screw which is coming in contact with the nut. And how much from this side also this portion. So what is remaining here? DC. This portion is DC. Again, how much is the thread thickness? That is T. DC into T, and overall you have to consider this pi. Pi into DC into T, and here multiplied by Z means number of threaded portion. 1, 2, 3. So look at this. I will show once again here. So therefore, this transverse shear stress in the screw is going W pi DC means for this core diameter, that means the portion of the screw which comes in contact with the nut. T means thickness of the thread, And Z means number of threads in engagement with the knot. Try to understand. This equation we are going to use to find out transverse shear stress in the screw. And in similar way or similar fashion, we have to find out transverse shear stress in the knot. How to find out? Again here W, but here for a knot portion. What is happening? Look at in the diagram. For a knot. Knot means here. Look at this. Now this portion of the, this is the portion of the screw, but for a nut, this is the portion. For a nut, this is the portion where the contact of the screw which is coming. And this portion, what is this? This is D, or nominal diameter, or largest diameter, or major diameter, D. D into this thickness T, and into circumference of this, that is pi. So what you will get, pi into D into T is the area. And into number of threads which comes in contact with the nut and the screw. Therefore, you will get here. Look at this. What area or shear area for a nut? Pi into D into T into number of Z. Z means number of threads in engagement with the, now here instead of nut, here you can write with the screw. With the screw in this portion. And which are same. So in this way, what you have to do? So you will get transverse shear stress induced in the screw and transverse shear stress induced in the nut. That's why N is the suffix and here S is the suffix. By using this expression, you can easily find out, or even though if it's given, you can find out the number of thread portion or number of threads which comes in contact of the nut with the screw. That means you can find out the Z also. You can find out the T also. You can use this expression to get this parameters also, no problem. This is about the design of the screw. But you know very well, there is a contact of screw and nut. Refer this diagram once again. I am showing by using the pen. Now here, look at this, this portion. Now here, there is a contact of this screw part and contact of this nut part. And because of this, what is happening here? The bearing pressure. I have already mentioned two terms, bearing stress or bearing pressure and the crushing stress. And there is a relative motion. That's why I am using bearing pressure term. Try to understand. If there is no relative motion, you can use the crushing stress. Now there is a bearing pressure in between the contacting surfaces. Contacting surfaces of the screw and the nut. And the bearing area that we have to find out. The SB is the bearing pressure is equal to force upon area. And how to find out the area? Again, here it's a cylindrical one, pi by 4 into D square is the general equation. But in this case, the, how much is the area of the screw and the nut which is coming in contact? And how to find out? Look, refer again this diagram. Here you will find this portion I have told here up to this. And from this side, the D minus DC. So this portion and this, and in between, what is this? This is DC and total is D. So you can use this to find out the area. So you will get this area for one thread. Area for one thread, pi by 4 into D square minus DC square. And for number of threads which are in contact between nut and screw, that is Z. So you will get SB, bearing pressure between screw and nut is equal to force W upon pi by 4 into D square minus DC into Z. Or you can send this 4 to this side. You will get SB is equal to this expression. So by using this, you can find out the bearing pressure J, D or DC, or find out the unit bearing pressure. Again here, how much is the bearing pressure generally used in Newton per mm square? This bearing pressure depends on, within 1 minute I will cover, material of the screw and the nut and rubbing velocity. And you can refer the chart available in data book, even the V.V. Bhandari's book. So for hand press, screw jack, then hoisting screw, lead screw, what is the material for screw that is steel, what is the material for a nut, bronze, cast iron, bronze. And based on that, you can select the value of bearing pressure in the range of 18 to 24 for a low speed application, speed is high. So by referring this chart, you will get the value of SB in Newton per mm square. This is permissible bearing pressure. This is about the design of screw and the nut. I hope you understood today's session. Thank you. Thank you very much. Tomorrow or day after tomorrow, we will solve some of the problems on the power screw. And Monday or the Tuesday, we will discuss about design of screw jack. I will explain or elaborate that thing during the session. Okay, thank you for today's session. I have reported V.V. Bhandari's book Design of Machine Element, 3rd edition, Megrahill publication. Thank you. If you have any problem, you can contact me through the WhatsApp number or mail me at pbkushari@kkwork.edu.in. Thank you. Thank you.